This is Pastor Randy Tinker at Trenton Ministry Center. I want to thank you for watching our program today. At TMC, we believe that through Jesus, we can change our city and impact our world. I pray you are blessed by today's program.
A little bit, because I'm going to preach two chapters in 2 Kings this morning. But the Lord knows all about that, and He'll help us. Amen. Turn with me to 2 Kings, the second chapter. No. 2 Kings, the 7th chapter. This morning we're going to be talking about really the acts of the man of God. And I can't talk about the acts of the man of God without talking about our pastors. Amen? So we're going to see that as we do it. God has placed Randy and Georgina here as our shepherds. He has set them here as the head, the covering for this house and this body. And so I see it all in this. And I want to say, this has just renewed my love for. I love the historical books in the Old Testament. I love to read the stories. There's some great stories here, and I'm just going to touch on some of the stories because I don't have time to really dig into them this morning. But I challenge you to get into the Old Testament and read some of these stories. The kings, you start with Joshua on. You can just read those and just really get into them. And I love them. And I love talking about Elisha. Tammy and I were talking earlier this morning, and there was Elijah. And there is Elisha, and sometimes they get all intermingled when I go to talk. So if I say the Jah, I'm going to be talking about Shah, okay? Elisha, as we share together. I'm just going to read one verse, and then I'm going to pray, but you need to pray. I have got so much inside of me this morning, and I just long for God to be able to bring it out for what He has. I know without a shadow of a doubt, this has been on me so heavy that God has it for this time. And I want you to know that it's a privilege. Brother Randy hears me say it often. I know, and it is a tremendous privilege for him to honor me, because I know he'd love to be up here after that worship and after that time, this praise team, he would love to be up here. But I'm so thankful that he gave me the opportunity of being able to share today. Look with me in chapter 7, verse 3. Now there were four lepers, men at the entrance of the gate, and they said to one another, "Why are we sitting here until we die?" I want to talk to you about vision and dream and destiny this morning. And I'm so excited about it. You're just going to have to pray for me. I was glad that Kathy said we're going to slow it down a little bit. You're going to have to pray that I can slow it down a little bit, because I know where I'm going. And I'm excited to get there, okay? But I want to talk to you from this step, right in the middle of this. These four unlikely men are going to set a story that we're going to share in a little bit. The introduction to this is pretty long, so you just be with me, pray for me, and do it now. Jesus, thank you for your presence in this place this morning. And we just ask you, Lord, that you'll just come and you'll just continue to speak to us. Because in these verses that we're going to share this morning is life. Lord, I believe there's some individuals out here that are sitting on their dreams. Lord, I believe there are individuals in this room this morning that for whatever reason, they're just still saying later, later. For whatever reason, Lord, they're putting off the things that you put in their heart. You show up in a service like this, Lord, and their heart's pounding and they want to, but something keeps them back for fulfilling the purpose, the destiny that you have called them into the kingdom for. And Lord, we're believing that today, before the end of this service, you're going to free some people up to step into their destiny. And for that, we'll give you praise in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. 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 I've got more notes this morning than I normally do, and I told Tammy it's I've got to have it, and I need to stay over here where I can just stay channeled on what really God has dropped into my heart, okay? The man Elisha, he's so much, I saw so much my pastor, and some of the things that God is doing here at Trenton Ministry Center, I saw it just sort of embodied in the life of Elijah in chapter 6 here. And so I just want you to stay with me, and I want you to see some of the things. I'm going to try my best not to read the whole thing, but you just bear with me. It's going to start right there in 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 1. I want you to look. Here's something that we see, first of all, about the man of God, Elisha. It says, "And the sons of the prophets said to Elisha, 'See now, the place where we dwell is too small for us.'" Can I get a witness in the house, huh? Huh? I see us trying to eat around here sometimes, and I see people sitting in the floor and sitting all over the place. But I also see in this here that they are other men of God coming together around our pastor. In Elisha's day, and if you'll read in the Old Testament, especially in historical books, Elijah had his school of prophets. Elisha, coming after him, had his school of prophets. It was young men that felt a calling upon their life, and they came around the man of God, and it's important to see that the man of God was the one that had the vision, but the vision came out of the ones that had come around him. And I want you to know there's a lot of vision in this house right here. There's a lot of dreams bubbling up and stirring up and happening, and they're coming around the man of God, Brother Randy. And he sees them and he hears them, and I'm just excited about what we're looking at. But I want you to see that vision starts with the man of God. The vision of this place is going to start with the man that's sitting right here. He is the man of God. He is the one that has placed it there. Vision to enlarge these facilities will grow and include several different things. But it's going to be the vision of the pastor. That's the way it was. That's the way it started out with Elisha here in the first part of this chapter. So Elisha goes on, let me just sort of ad-lib this, okay? He said, okay, it's time, basically, for what Elijah said. They said, well, we need to go cut some trees. We need to go bring some beams back from the Jordan. And so he says, okay. And they say, will you go with us? I love that. It's always like little preacher guys. They say, we're going to go do this down here, but would you just at least come along with us? And I feel that way sometimes with my pastor, wanting him to come be a part of it. But as I see that, here's where the man of God he exemplifies vision, but he also exemplifies power. I want you to notice what happened. And it goes down. Look at verse 6. Well, I guess I need to tell you what happened in verse 4-5. They're down there chopping these trees by the Jordan. So far, Randy hadn't told anybody in here to go chop trees. We may get to that, huh? But they go down by the Jordan. They're chopping down trees to hew beams to drag them back up to enlarge the place where they're meeting, because it's not big enough anymore. And they get down there, and they're chopping away on those trees. And one of them hits the tree, and a borrowed axe comes apart, and the axe head falls out in the river. And so what do they do? That young preacher boy said, "Master, what are we going to do? I borrowed this axe, and it's the metal, the end of it, the axe head is in the river. It's sunk." The man of God, Elisha, walks up and says, "Where'd it go?" "Right over there." He takes a stick and he throws it in the water. And if you know the story, what happens? It floats. Steel floats to the top, or the metal, whatever it was construed of in that day, it floats up to the top of the water. So there's not only vision with the man of God, there's also power demonstrated with the man of God. And I want you to know, in my pastor, There's power demonstrated for him. He walks and talks and preaches and proclaims from this in a sense of authority and power that God instills in him and God gives him. Another thing that we're going to see about the man of God, Elisha, in this sixth chapter is down in verse 12. And I love this. I'm just going to have to tell you the story a little bit. The Syrians are always fighting against Israel. And they're coming against Israel, and they get together. The king brings them together and says, here's what we're going to do. We're going to defeat the Israelites this time. And they set up the plan. And when they get there, no Israelites. Nothing can happen. Somebody's telling them the plans. That happens not one time, but it happens two times. The king pulls them all together, and he says, what are we going to do? We've got a mole. I got that on CSI on TV. We got a mole. Somebody's telling the enemy our plans. One of them says, oh, no, it's not one of us. The man of God, Elisha, is telling the king of Israel what you say in your bedroom. Huh? That was it. The man of God had discernment. The enemy could not come again. God shows the plans of the enemy before the enemy can cause problems. An important part, an important position that Pastor Randy has at our church is he has discernment. God gives him a discernment for this entire body, not just the entire body, but he can give that discernment for me and you if we will see him as the man of God, if we will hold him at that place. There is discernment that God has given to the man of God. The next thing you can see, verse 17. I'm going to have to tell this story too. I can't just read the verse. It's a beautiful story. Elijah is sitting in his house. I think he's in Dothan. It's about 7 miles from Samaria, where we're going to be at in a few minutes. And the king's mad because Elisha's been telling everybody his plans, things he talks in his bedroom. My, what? You ever been sitting in here and you wondering if he's looking in your mailbox at home? Huh? Yeah, discernment. That's what that is. And so he's mad that Syrian king is mad, so he sends an army, it says a great army, and they go and they circle the place where Elijah's at, circle that city. And I see Elijah in there eating pancakes, you know, just chilling, you know. And his servant's running back to the window, and he said, the army's getting bigger and bigger, that you got to come and look at this army. You know what Elijah says while he's eating his pancakes and grits? He says, the ones that are with us outnumber the ones that are with them. And he just keeps on eating. It wasn't enough. He said, yeah, you're saying that, but I'm seeing this army out here, and that's all I see. The man of God, Elisha, drops his head, and he says, Lord, open his eyes so he can see. So he goes back to the window, and he is amazed. He sees chariots, and he sees the hills lined with them and surrounding the great army. And he comes back and he says, there's more of us than there is of them. And that came from the man of God. The man of God here prayed that the eyes of his servant would be open. God convinces all who are open that the work of the enemy is covered. And I love it about this. My pastor is my covering. And I tell him all the time, I said, you know, I'm thankful you make the big bucks. You know, I can come under you, you know. But anyway, I love it because I'm under his covering. And he can give me insight sometimes when it looks like the enemy is drawing in around us and it looks like I may be overtaken, and he's able to say, look here and look there and look here and look there. And it brings about a sense. That is something that you and I can see in this man He helps us to trust God. There's sometimes you just can't make it happen by looking at paper. There's sometimes you can't make it happen by listening to the report or the witness of other people. So you need a man of God to remind you of the Son of God and His ability to be able to open our eyes and trust in Him. Amen? Amen. Yes, give the Lord praise. There's something else that I see about the man of God in chapter 6, and it's in verse 18. I'm just going to tell you. You can read it along, read it afterwards. If I get it wrong, call me and let me know. The enemy, the Syrian army, the great army that's behind the greater army, they start advancing. Here's what the man of God does. He goes out and he says, God, strike them blind. You know what happened? They all went blind. Blind. It took them and he led them like little kids. Them mighty warriors. They were leading them around like little kids. And they took them into Samaria. And we'll pick that up in just a few moments. And they didn't even kill them. They just humiliated them. Because God had showed up. And he had used the man of God to show his authority. I want you to know that one of the great blessings that you and I have because of our man of God is the authority that he has over this house. The authority that he can cover us with. The authority that he can rebuke the devil on my behalf and on your behalf and others. And I'm going to tell you, it's not just in this house. And it's not just in this house where people see the man of God, Brother Randy, as having authority. There's several things that we have working in the community. And I sat down with a group of community leaders that are helping and we're doing some things. And I went to them and I said, which way would you like for this to go? Which way would you like to see us do this? How would you like for us to accomplish this task that you're asking TMC to do? You know what they told me? Go ask your pastor. Because he is our covering. He is our. They're not even here. They don't even go to Trenton Ministry Center. And they look to our pastor as being the authority to some of the things that they're doing in their life. You need to give God praise for that. That's the most amazing thing. I walk out of those meetings and I'm thinking, where in the world did all of this come from? And it's happening more and more. And God is doing it. And God is blessing. That's the things that have authority. Elisha said, strike them blind. They were blind. They get them and they take them into town. Boy, the old king of Israel, he's pumped now. He wants to kill them. Elisha says, no, let's don't kill them. Let's have a celebration. Huh? Hey, let's have a celebration. Let's celebrate the great works of God is what Elisha, the man of God, was doing. And our pastor can do it better than anybody else. When he comes into this place, he helps remind us and he helps us to be in a celebratory way. And you and I ought to be celebrating the good things that God is doing in this place. The good things that God is doing. You and I need to celebrate it right now. The church grow. The baptisms at the jail this afternoon and right out here next Sunday afternoon. You and I need to look at all of that that's happened over just the last few months. You and I need to get to a place where we'll celebrate recovery. We need to celebrate what God is doing in that. And I want you to know, and I'll explain this even more just a little bit later. Celebrate recovery is not mine. That was birthed in the heart of this man right here. He's the one that said, we're going to do it. And I'll explain a little bit more about that. So you and I need to celebrate those things. You and I need to celebrate. Last night, I heard already people were saved. Right here through the youth service. There are people that are saved upstairs in our children's services. The things that are going on up there. And I know I'm a little partial sometimes. I can't quit talking about celebrate recovery. But right here, this past Thursday night, was a young man giving his life to Jesus Christ that didn't even know who Jesus was, never been in church, never knew anything. He received Jesus right here.
Right here was a young lady that had been backslid on God, raised in church all of her life, backslid on God, came to Jesus, had a breakthrough in her heart and life, and she received it. Yes. But here's the thing. From her to him were about 20 others giving their heart, just pour, and they're not standing here. They're laid out on the altar, pouring their hearts out. Some of them pouring their hearts out for family. That's how, and you and I ought to be celebrating that. You and I ought to get to a place where we're celebrating the things that God is doing in our lives. And these things that are happening, are you with me? These things that are happening were birthed right here with Randy and Georgina. Right here's where these things were birthed at. And those things that are happening because the man of God and the woman of God have took their rightful place at Trent Ministry Center. And the best is yet to come. Amen. God is saving. He's transforming, he's delivering, he's calling men and women to take their rightful place into the kingdom of God. Amen. There are people right here in this room this morning. I told them I wouldn't call their names. There's some people right here in this room this morning that just a few months ago, your life was turned upside down. But today, you're walking in the goodness of God and you're looking for ways to step into the kingdom and be a man and woman of God. Kathy said, slow down. Slow down. I can't. We haven't seen the last of any of this. Here are some dreams. I told you there's some dreams and visions bubbling out here in this congregation. Here are some of the dreams that are happening. Oh, just hold your lid there. And it's coming to the pastor. Now, I love that. You know, he's used to Jonathan and I, because we keep going at him until his eyes glaze over. If you're ever talking to him and his eyes glaze over, just go on. Yeah, you know, it's not time. You come back at a later time and see if it'll all work out. But here's some dreams that are happening right here in the congregation. Some of us see a soup kitchen at Fred's. I want the whole shopping center. I don't want just Fred's. Some people see right behind this wall back here a fellowship hall all the way from corner to corner and all the way to the road with a big commercial size kitchen in there. Huh? That sounds pretty good. Do you know this city block that's right up here? It only has just a couple of corners out of it. The rest of it is wide open. Do you know that some people see this entire city block in the name of Jesus and through Trent Ministry Center doing a rehab, doing counseling center, doing all kinds of things out there in that city block. Some people see an apartment complex back there. And, you know, we get tired of seeing that old railroad track anyway. I see an apartment complex back there helping people that need a place to stay, being able to give them some stability in their lives. Do you notice We've been trying to buy this lot right over here for years. But for some reason, God wanted us to have a house on the lot. Tammy said, you better not say that. They're going to be taping that. That man may hear that. Maybe he needs to hear it. God has already ordained some of that. Amen? Also, listen to this. Some of you pastors only heard just a portion of this. A private community with cabins for 12 to 15 individuals or families who needs a hand up. Huh? Yes. A sanctuary that's going to seat several hundred, maybe thousand. We don't know. It's going to be there, and it's going to be for the glory of God. You'd say, well, Rex, give the Lord praise for just the dreams and the visions that are coming. You say, is all of that God leading? I don't know. Well, we are closer than you think about doing some of this that I've just talked about. You say, when's it going to happen? When the man of God says it's going to happen. Huh? When he says it's going to happen. And you can believe when he says it's going to happen, he's heard from him. huh? I've seen it already too many times. I trust him. I trust him with everything that I have. These things are going to come about. Now, this part has been a whole lot about the pastor, but I'm fixing to switch gears. Huh? When is it going to happen? When the man of God hears from heaven. And, everybody say and. When we step into the dreams and the destiny that God has bubbling in our hearts. And I want you to stay with me for these next few moments, and I'm going to wrap it up. It's going to be a few minutes. All of this, and we can all get pumped up, and I don't know how it happens. And I got to get back to my notes, right? They didn't tell where this will go. We can get all pumped up in here. Those are great dreams. And then we go home. We might be back Wednesday night. And we might be back Sunday. Are y'all listening to me? It can't happen unless you and I step into what God. I believe from this end of this room, all over this room, there's a dream. There's a dream planted in your heart. There's a dream. Maybe a small, maybe something small. I say if it's small, dream bigger. Dream bigger. Don't you dream in your own abilities. You dream in God's abilities. There's some things that's bubbling up inside of me. There is absolutely no way I can make it happen. If it happens, it's going to have to be God and God's glory that brings it about. So you dream big. But one thing's for sure, He's put that dream in you. I hear some of you talking. I hear your hearts. I hear some of the things that's bubbling in you. He's ready for you to step into it. He's ready for you to do it. I'm convinced. Some of us are just waiting on our dream, either to jump into what God's already doing. Some of you would be excited. You hear some of the things that's going on. I want to be a part of that. Jump in. Jump in. Be a part of it. And then some of you, listen to me. Some of you may have something birthing inside of you for this house that's never even entered our thoughts or our minds. Huh? Something totally new and something amazing. And it's God that's bringing it about. And I want you to do this. Oh. This is just not coming up with something to do. This is life and death. Are you listening to me? This is life and death. There's some of you gonna... Oh, Jesus. There's some of you going to dry up and fall off of the vine dead if you don't get up and get into the dream and the destiny God has for you for your life. It's going to happen. And then for others, it may be there's families at stake here. There's co-workers at stake here. You and I have somehow we've got to be able to get up. The most important thing for the believer has got to be to some way invest our time in bringing out the gospel of Jesus Christ that can turn things around for every individual if they'll just turn to Him. And if our focus and our dreaming and all that we're doing is going in another direction, we are shorting ourselves. And we're shorting our families. And we're shorting those people that God has placed around us. But if we can get a hold of it instead of life, it's going to be life abundant. There's going to be some things that are going to be coming about that's going to blow us away. This is a life and death thing. I've got to say this, and I don't want to say this, but I've got to say this. Did you say, help us, Jesus? Help us, Jesus. Thank you. I needed that. This is not about you. It's not even about you. It's not about you looking good. We are looking for, and I believe God is looking for, servant leaders. We don't need a chief that had never led nobody. And it seems like, and I know I poke at Ryan's generation, but it's not Ryan's generation. It's the attitude of everybody. Everybody wants to jump in if they can be chief. It ain't about you being chief. You and I need to get in. If we'll serve people, God will open a door for us to be able to do something. He'll do it. He'll do it. You just start serving people. You just start making a difference in people's lives. And I'm going to tell you, you'll have more coming at you and more opportunity to do than you ever dreamed possible if you will serve. I came in here, I told somebody, I came in here a Wednesday or two ago. I was coming just to check, make sure some things were together for CR on Thursday. You know what I walked into? See, some of these rooms back here, we change out and use them three different ways in a week's time. You know who was setting the rooms up for the next night? These two. Folding chairs, folding tables. And there's a part of me that just, I love the heart of my pastors. They don't care what it is. They don't care what it needs to be done around here. They're the first ones to roll up their sleeve. They're the first ones that want to get involved in it. But then there was another part of me, it broke my heart. You know, they weren't ministering to people because they were carrying chairs and tables. And my heart just broke in that. God needs us just to be willing to get in here and carry a few chairs and tables and see what God will open up and what He will bring our way. So some of us, as those four lepers that I hadn't forgot about, I'm going to get back to in just a minute. I'm probably going to have to hurry. Here's some reasons why some of us are sitting here. In us sitting here, people are dying. Was it Booth, the founder of Salvation Army? Wasn't it him that had the dream of people marching off a cliff into hell, the hellfire? Somehow I say, Jesus, give us that picture, because it's happening. You know, I could have filled three buses full of people playing on Sunday morning this morning on the way to church. And I'm not against any of the stuff they were doing and playing, okay? But my heart, there are people marching headlong to a cliff off into a lake of fire that burns forever and ever. So you and I, sitting on our dream, is a matter of life and death. You got to get that. You got to catch it. So why are we still sitting on it? We are where we are because of our choices. Well, things are just, it's not a good time, or things are bad, or somebody told me I'd never amount to anything. I don't have time. You don't want me to get started on that. You got time to do whatever it is you want to do. Listen to me. You've got time to do whatever you want to do. And I'm going to move on. Some of us will never taste our dream because we can't let go of the world. You can't hold the world in this hand and Jesus in this hand and figure you're going to taste of the destiny that God created you to be. You're going to have to get to a place where you're going to shake loose from the world. Shake that thing off and do it. And I wish I could do it like Peter was doing it. Peter in, I can't remember which chapter in one, in the first Peter, he cries out, he says, I beg you, abstain from fleshly lust. Because they'll destroy you. They'll pull you away. In a sense, what Peter was saying, they'll pull you away from what God created you to do if you don't flee them, if you don't get away from them, if you don't sustain. Some of us are still sitting on our dreams because our dream would interfere with our play stuff. Your flesh is going to cry out till Jesus comes. But are you going to be man and woman enough to say no to the flesh and yes to the Spirit of God that lives and moves and has His being inside of you? That's your choice. the former prophet, the Elijah, standing on Mount Carmel. Choose you this day whom you're going to serve. If God be God, serve Him. If Baal be Baal, serve him. But the whole context of that is serve. Do something. This thing is not just about you. It's not about us. There's times I get tired. There's times I get discouraged. There's times I just want to lay down. But I can't. How can we sleep when people are dying? How can we do it? Oh. Somebody say, move on, Rex. Move on, Rex. Church and kingdom work is not optional. It's not optional. What are you doing? Some of us are here because someone else's actions were stuck playing the victim role. Some even blame God. Our feelings get hurt. Some hypocrite messed with us. Some people are damaged, and I find more and more damaged people, more and more hurting people. I'm talking some deep hurts. Abuse, oh my Lord, like you've never heard of. I never even thought it. Right, not in New York City, right here in Dade County. I mean, just some tremendous hurts. But we're living in a society, folks, that want to keep us in our victim roles. They want to keep you bound. Devil wants to keep you bound as a victim. But Jesus, listen to me, Jesus wants to take you from being a victim and make you a victor. Huh? Amen. He wants to take that circumstance that Satan meant to take you out with. He wants to turn it around and be the very thing he's going to use to help you be able to serve him and be able to reach the hearts and lives of other people. You'd say, well, Rex, I've tried. How in the world do I do that? Jesus was in a temple. Pharisees. I don't like Pharisees. I'm in good company. I don't believe Jesus did either. Read the book. The Pharisees are giving Jesus a hard time in the temple. And a man slips in over there, and this is Rex paraphrase, so just bear with me. And he's over there, and he's got this old arm kind of covered up. And boy, the old Pharisees were saying, yeah. They were trying to make a mockery of things. They was trying to make a do. They was going to make a victim. They were going to victimize the victim that was standing over there with a withered hand. And they were giving Jesus a what for, you know? You know what Jesus did? He said, come here. Somebody needs to hear me right here. If you've got a hurt, if you've got something that's pulling at you and defeating you in your life, listen to me. Jesus called a man over there and he said, stretch it out. He had it kind of covered up, no gnarled up, ugly, bony, skinny thing. And he uncovered it, and he began to break it out, and he began to twist, and he began to stretch that thing out. And all of a sudden, it was just like the other one. It was whole, and it was, God longs to do that. But somehow you are going to have to get in a place where you open that thing up and let Jesus in there. And let him heal. Don't hold on to that hurt. Sometimes we get so used to the hurt, it becomes a comfort to us. Break free from it in Jesus' name and let him do something in your life. I got to move on. Life and death. This is all about life and death. Say it with me. Life and death. Say it again, life and death. When I sat in my pastor's office, here's a little caveat to CR. I'm going somewhere. I don't know if I'm getting off work or I've been to town. I don't know what it was. I remember being in my car. Brother Randy calls me. He says, brother, I just want to see if you could help me. I'm supposed to be in a meeting tonight about celebrate recovery or something or other, and there's several pastors going to be there, and I can't. Something's come up. I can't be there. Would you go? I said, sure, I'll go. So I go to this meeting, and I walk in there, and there was three, four other churches represented here in our county. And there was a pastor from Fort Payne. There was a CR leader in Fort Payne and a couple of people from Dade County, Jason Rook and Joseph Chambers. with the two people that just had a dream of a Celebrate Recovery in Dade County. And so we sat down there and I listened, and it just piqued my curiosity, a little bit. And, I come and I let Pastor know, and there was another meeting, and the goal was, I think Randy and I had a meeting, something like this. Now, brother, this may be something good for our church. He looked at me and he said, but you can't do anything else. And he said, our plates are full. We don't need to do anything. I said, yeah. But let's look at it. Maybe something. So we keep doing that. And it wound up Trent Minister Center around the table. Not by our choice. Because Pastor and I were saying, boy, we don't have this. We don't have a kitchen. We do, but we don't really have a kitchen for what we need, okay? Everybody with me? Not slamming what we got. I thank God for what we got, all right? So we saw that it would be better, and we just left to throw it behind another church in Dade County. And when it come down to it, there's only one church, TMC. So we did our study about it and all of that, and I come in and I sit down in well, it's the couch now, but back then it was the chairs, and I'm sitting in front of Brother Randy's desk, and I said, there's nobody left in this thing but me, but us. And I said, what are we going to do? And he sat there a minute, and we'd both been praying about it, and he did this. We're going to do it. We don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to do it. We don't even really know what all it's going to take to do it, but we're going to do it. And we started with 25 people training in January, and we have not missed a Thursday night, Christmas, New Year's, Thanksgiving, all of those things. We've been right here in this place reaching the hurting, the helpless, the ones in the community that nobody else is really reaching out to, and we have been here every time, and there are people that are right here in this room as a result of Celebrate Recovery. Some of them could testify. It's been life and death. Life and death. Life and death was in that decision. Now, bring that all together to help us to see these decisions that we make to either do or not do are life and death. They're not just a, let's just go do something fun. Let's do something. No, it's life and death. And it's birthed in the heart of God. And it's placed in the heart of the man of God, Brother Randy, our pastor. And it filters down to the rest of us. And I tell him all the time, thank you. Thank you for giving me the opportunity just to come into this place. 25 people at the altar Thursday night. I walk around here and I just say, Jesus, Jesus. I don't know what else to say because he's bringing all of that. Life and death. Life and death. I want to tell my story. I'm going to have to skip the story. You can say for the second service. I may have time in the second service. I don't know. There's four lepers. I'm going to give you a down dirty, okay? Go back home and read it. Syrian king decided he'd had enough. He put an army around Samaria, choked the life out of them. He wasn't going to go in there because he knew Elijah was in there. I think that's my opinion. So he's just going to encircle the city and starve them to death, and it's working. They are selling donkey heads for 8 times what you used to could get a bag of flour for. They're also selling, and I'm trying to choose my words, Georgina. They're selling dove poop. If you don't believe me, you read the story. I don't have time to really get into it and read it. They're starving to death. But then they get in such a desperate situation that two women get together and say, the only way we're going to solve this problem, the only way we're going to survive is one day we're going to eat your son and the next day we're going to eat my son. And so the first day came and they ate a little kid. And they showed up the next day going to eat the second kid. And the woman had hid her kid. And the woman's crying out. the king of Israel stripped off it. He's got sackcloth and he's fallen. But he's mad at the man of God and he goes.
The man of God says, he could have said this. At twilight, it's going to shift. They mocked him. It's going to turn around. These four lepers that I had at the gate, they said, why are we going to sit here and we die? We can't go inside Samaria and get any food. They're not going to give us any food. There's nothing to eat in there. We're going to die. If we sit here, we're going to die. There might be a chance if we'll go into the camp of the enemy. If we'll go into the camp of the enemy, we might live. Long story short, they get up, those four men, they're walking down the hill scared to death. At twilight is when they got up. Hang on to that. At twilight, they headed down the hill to the Syrian camp. They get down there and they see donkeys and horses and they see clothes and they see weapons and they see tents, but they don't see any people. They go walking up to the tent. They crack the tent up. Nobody's in there. They run in there. Ooh, they've been eating. They was just eating, having a big time. They eat everything in that tent, went to the next tent, eating in there. One of them said, we got to go tell our brothers back in Samaria. I'm sure there was one of them in the bunch said, they didn't want to associate with us, so I'm not going to associate with them. I don't care. They can all die. But somebody said, we can't do that. And I'm hoping from one side of this room to the other, somebody says, I can't sit here anymore while people die. I got to step out. So they go back to the camp. They tell the king, he thinks it's an ambush. He's reluctant to send it down there. They scrape up three horses that they hadn't eaten. And they send them into the camp and they find it. There's food. And we find the story is the enemy had left because they had heard an army coming off of the hills. And it was such a mighty army. They took off running, left everything right where it was at. And so, and you know when that happened? Somebody say it. Twilight. Twilight. Twilight, the four lepers went down, came back in the city. Short story. I know I got to cut it short. Kathy, you guys come. I got to pull this thing in. But four unlikely people saved an entire city from starving to death. Food was available right there at the hand of the enemy. And God had brought it about and had given it to them and had placed it. But if somebody hadn't made up their mind to get up and go, the miracle would have never happened. So, you. Somebody say you. Say me. You may be just minutes away from something shifting in your life for plenty. And I'm not talking about food in this instance. I'm talking about being able to find your place, be able to step into your destiny. It's not about food, but it's about peace that passes all understanding. It's about joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's about fruit. It's about being able to stand and see somebody you've invested time in come and give their heart and life to Jesus Christ. It's about that. We all have a dream. Even the unlikeliest one in this room. The unlikeliest one in this room may be the one that's going to step in and cause the shift to plenty in this house. And it may be you. It may be you. Could be either one of us. But will never happen as long as we sit right here. I'm going to ask you a question. Three, actually. What life and death dream are you sitting on? What is it going to take for you to trust God and just do it? Maybe you need to let go of some things. Maybe you need to let Him heal some things. But just do it. Just let Him. I beg you, let do it. And I love this part here. Oh, what kind of celebration
is tuning up already, anticipating you stepping into your dream, because the portals of heaven can see when you step into your dream, the multitude that's going to be affected by it. They can already see it. So they're celebrating going on all over heaven. I believe they're tuning up and they're getting ready, for because some of you right here in this room, it's twilight time and it's time to shift. Let's stand together. Jesus, I've done the best I could with I just ask you, Lord, that you'll just settle in upon us. Help us be excited, Lord, about what's going on. But Lord, help us even become more excited of beginning to think that there is a place in it for us. Lord, I'm happier than I've ever been in my life. Lord, just because you're helping me. And Lord, I'm begging you, pour that same thing out on everybody in this room. Give us, Lord, a longing to step in. You don't know how it's going to happen. Don't know how it's going to come about. But Lord, help us just step into your perfect will for our lives. They're fixing to lead us into worship. And if the Lord has spoken to you in the midst of all of this morning, there is a dream bubbling inside of you and you've been sitting on it. It's twilight time for you. Step forward. Just accept whatever it is that God's got in store for you in your life as they lead us to worship. Ladies, take us to the throne.
Thank you for watching our program today. If you don't have a home church, we'd love for you to join us at TMC. Our service times are Sunday morning at 10:30 and Wednesday evening discipleship classes at 7. Check us out on Facebook, and you can hear today's sermon on iTunes. Please join us next week. And at Trenton Ministry Center, we believe TMC is the place to be.